We're talking with Andy McCarthy. The book is Ball of Collusion, The Plot to Rig an Election and Destroy a Presidency. And Andy, as you point out in the book, initially we were led to believe that it was the electronic surveillance of Carter Page that got this all rolling. And then when not much came out of that, they said, oh, actually, it was the human intelligence of these various people that met with George Papadopoulos, both of these people unpaid, pretty low on the totem pole. And as you say in the book, there is basically zero, zilch, nada in terms of evidence that there was any sort of conspiracy between the Trump campaign and the Kremlin. So the question becomes, why did it take 2 years for Bob Mueller to conclude that? If that was fairly simple to get to, was he waiting to see what he could see on an obstruction line, given Trump's tweets and things of that nature? Or was there another reason it took that long?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's one that hopefully we'll get a solid answer. I mean, I offer theory, but you know, someday we'll hopefully get a real factual accounting of when exactly Mueller knew that there was no chance that he was going to make a collusion case, which, you know, the premise of this investigation was that the Trump campaign and operatives of the Kremlin were joined together in a cyber espionage conspiracy, which involved hacking and propaganda operations in order basically to steal the election from Mrs. Clinton. I mean, that was the theory of collusion. And I always thought, Greg, that they called it collusion as opposed to conspiracy because they didn't really have evidence of conspiracy. Collusion is kind of a weasel word, as we discussed before. You and I are colluding by having this conversation.
Right.
It doesn't mean that it's, you know, it can be sinister, it can be benign, it can be something in between, but it's not a crime. There's no crime of collusion. And I think they used the word because they didn't have what you usually have in investigations, which is conspiracy. That's the thing that they were looking for. But the reason that the Mueller question is so interesting is, you know, first of all, if you look at the indictments that he returned, you know, a lot is made of the number of people who were indicted, including the number of people in Trump's orbit that were indicted. And it's rarely mentioned that the couple of dozen or so Russians that Mueller indicted had nothing to do with the Trump campaign, and the Trump campaign officials that Mueller indicted had nothing to do with Russia. You know, there was no allegation in these many charging instruments that Mueller filed that there was any kind of a conspiracy. But I find, aside from that, I find the Russian indictments Mueller found the most interesting because they're indicative of what you would figure in terms of common sense, which is that the Russians neither wanted nor needed any help from not just the Trump campaign, but anybody. They know how to do this kind of thing. They've done it historically. They don't need partners in the West. And, you know, the schemes that Mueller charged, you know, some of them go back to 2014 before Trump was ever in the race. And some of them go beyond his election. And the reason that's relevant is some of the operations are actually anti-Trump, which obviously Trump wouldn't have participated in. So when you look at the indictments that Mueller filed, it's quite clear not only that, you know, that there wasn't a Trump-Russia conspiracy, but that they affirmatively knew that there wasn't a Trump-Russia conspiracy. Then the other thing I think is interesting is in connection with Carter Page, we now know that the FBI and the Justice Department went four times to the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court between October of 2016 and June of 2017 to get warrants to conduct surveillance on Page, who was a former Trump campaign official. And in each of those warrants, the FBI lays out what Russia's cyber espionage operations are. And in each one, the FBI and the Justice Department assert that the FBI believes that both Page and perhaps others in the Trump campaign are complicit in Russia's cyber espionage operations. So they explicitly say that what they're investigating is Trump campaign complicity in Russia's nefarious operations against the election. That's all interesting for a variety of reasons, not least that the last page of FISA warrant was in, as I said, June of 2017, which means that in September of 2017, they would have been due to re-up the surveillance. These are 90-day surveillance warrants, so they would have been due to go, if they wanted to continue the surveillance, they would have been due to go back in September of 2017. And what's interesting about that is they didn't. Going back would have required reaffirming everything that they had alleged up until now, including this idea that the Trump campaign and Russia were in cahoots. I note that by September 2017, Mueller was now on the investigation for about 4 months, and certainly had his by then he had his sea legs under him. It was his investigation. He had to have been the one to decide not to go back to the FISA court and reaffirm those claims. And secondly, Greg, by September 2017, virtually everyone at either the FBI or the Justice Department that had anything to do with the FISA surveillance is gone, has either been removed by disciplinary proceedings or has been transferred or has been fired or what have you. So it seems to me that there's a lot of indication, if you look at everything in terms of Mueller's work output and the decision-making that had to have gone on in autumn of 2017, there sure is a lot of indication that they knew at that point that there was no possibility of proving a Trump-Russia conspiracy. And I think it's a very important question why, if that's the case, the investigation continued as it did until March of 2019. And at the very least, you wonder, you know, why on earth didn't they put out an interim report, even if they wanted to continue the obstruction investigation and whatever else they were doing? Why not put out an interim report that just says, you know, we want to let the country know we don't consider President Trump to be a subject in the Russia part of the investigation, in the 2016 election meddling part of the investigation? Why not do that rather than make the president govern under a cloud for 2 years? It just it really raises a lot of questions that I think we deserve answers to.
Andrew C. McCarthy, former Chief Assistant U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of New York. He's now a Fox News Channel contributor and a columnist and contributing editor at National Review. The brand new book, Ball of Collusion, The Plot to Rig an Election and Destroy a Presidency. In the next installment of our conversation about this important book, we're going to be looking at two important things. First of all, how the DNC email hack might have been embarrassing for the party, but it was a huge help in trying to build the case for a Trump-Russia collusion story. And we'll discuss how Trump's own conduct helped to fuel legitimacy for this probe. I'm Greg Corombos, reporting for Radio America.